Get over here! Come here!
Hello, hello. You are muted, my good sir.
Oh, can you hear me now?
I can hear you now, yes.
Yes, I just wanted to say thank you, man, for this opportunity. Like, I really been a fan of yours since I was a kid.
Well, I see that. That's a very nice shirt you're wearing.
Yeah, my assistant got it for me, man.
Right on.
But yeah, other than that, man, I'm just ready to have some fun. I'm ready
Okay.
for you to get to know me and likewise and everything like that. But I just wanted to explain to you about my platform and my YouTube channel.
Okay.
Mainly it's about mental health and depression, because I've been through a whole lot of deaths in my family and went through a whole lot of depression and anxiety, PTSD at a young age. And once I was able to come out of that, I wanted to help people, wanted to give back to my community, just show everyone the seriousness of depression and mental health and stuff like that, because that's considered taboo to us men.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to give back. And now I've been just going around just locally and out of town, meeting people, talking to people, allowing them to tell their stories.
Okay. I think that's wonderful, man. Congratulations to you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. But yeah, let's get started, man. I did a lot of research on you and stuff like that,
Uh-oh.
and well, I don't know what's true and what's not. So maybe you could like debunk it
I
and
got
stuff.
you.
But but yeah, just looking at your videos, man, you are a real fighter, like compared to most of the like martial artists and stuff like that. Like, you have some deadly kicks, man. You kick pretty hard.
Well, I try, and that comes from growing up in the martial arts.
Yeah, so what made you become a martial artist? Like, what was the influence behind that?
My dad is the founder and creator of our style and our system of martial arts, which is called Red Dragon Karate. He started this way back in 1965. So we've been around for this is our 58th year in business. But when I was young, my dad was my hero and I wanted to be around him. So I went to the studio and started learning martial arts.
Okay, yeah. And just, learning from your dad and stuff like that, like, would you say you guys have like similarities, or did you adapt your own style?
So here's a fun fact about our studio, Red Dragon, that my dad started is America's first mixed martial arts style. Because back in the 1960s, my dad was doing what was unheard of at the time, and that was he was learning multiple styles and combining the best moves that he thought from every style to put them all together and to make one system of martial arts. So back in the, I don't know how much you know about the martial arts, but back in the when it in the early 60s, martial arts in America was really in its infancy stage, and it was very segmented. You were either, a Japanese stylist or Korean stylist or a Chinese stylist. You didn't cross the streams, as they say. But my dad was like, "No, I'm not going to listen to that because that's not a law. This is America, and I can do what I want." And he started doing it, and it just kind of developed and went from there.
Okay, so pretty much like how Bruce Lee caught flak for teaching martial artists, so your dad was pretty much catching flak. Wow.
And so here's the cool thing. So back in those days, the stuff you see, some of the stuff you see in the movies from those old Kung Fu movies is actually real. There was this unwritten law back in the day that if you were doing something that other martial artists didn't agree with and they came to your studio and challenged you and you lost the fight, you had to close your studio.
Wow,
Right?
that's crazy.
So I'm telling you that to tell you this. During this time, right now it's 2023.
Yeah.
We've never closed. So my dad has some great stories about people that come to challenge him. My dad was a badass man. He never lost when it came to stuff like that.
Yeah, I agree. I agree, because otherwise, y'all would have been shut down by now. So
that's right.
Yeah, so my question to you was, so you've been practicing like martial artists since like you was like a teenager?
No, or, man, like, I started when I was adult 4 years old.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because I just wanted to just get a timeline. So I bet you was just like the baddest. Like, did you attend like public school or you was
Yeah, public
homeschooled?
school. Public school. Yeah, I started martial arts training when I was 4 years old. And I made my black belt when I was 10. It took me 6 years. I failed my first black belt test because my dad was my teacher and I didn't think he was going to like test me, like, because I was young and dumb and that's what happens. And so, yeah, I did it and I got crushed and it taught me a very important lesson. You gotta work hard. You gotta put in the work to get the things that you want. So that was kind of important too. But so yeah, I've been in this, the story I tell, which is true, is I don't remember wearing diapers. I just remember wearing a little karate uniform and running around the studio.
Wow, man. And I'm glad that you said that because everyone don't admit like their first loss or their first defeat or just first, I would say, just discretion, you know? So mm-hmm. we have to, I feel like as human beings, especially you being in your legend of caliber, that it's really important to just let everybody know, like, I didn't win everything. Nothing was handed to me. I really had to work hard because that happened to me as far as like with this platform, with the show. It's a lot of interviews that I wanted to do, but people didn't show up, but I just had kept going.
Mm-hmm.
I just really believed in myself, really paced myself, and just really realizing that I'm running my own race at the end of the day. So there's no competition as far as that, but it's just all
That's
about
right.
hard work, dedication, and just believing that you can do it first. But yeah, I wanted to discuss with you about, you know, how did you get into Hollywood? Like, was you caught like with an agent or you just was already in the game?
No, I wasn't already in the game. So like a lot of young martial artists at the time, you know, although my dad was my hero, Bruce Lee was on in the movies, right? So, you know, I used to watch him and be like, that is so cool. And, you know, I always had this inside my head. I'm like, it'd be so cool if I could do our style on TV or in the movies someday. I always wanted to do it. It was one of those things that I thought about, but I didn't know really how to go about it. And, you know, the proximity to Hollywood, you know, I'm in Southern California, so we're in that area, but that doesn't mean a whole lot to do it. So I got a few opportunities early in my career to do some like B movie stuff, like the early ninja movies and things like that, because my dad, having been in the arts for a long time and being connected in the community, he helped a lot of people in the martial arts industry become movie stars, like Shokazugi, who was like, if the 80s ninja craze. Yeah, that was one of my dad's friends, and he helped him get into the movies. Tadashi Yamashita was another guy who was a local martial arts legend. My dad helped get into the movies. So through those opportunities, I got to be like small little bit parts and background fighters and things like that. And, you know, in Hollywood, there's this saying, it's not who you know, it's who knows you. Because the people that are on a movie today that may be, you know, the production assistant or the gopher, well, they're in the industry too. And all of a sudden they're going to move up the ladder and they're going to become a producer or writer or director. And, you know, over time, those people move up and they're like, oh, I remember working with that guy. He was nice. I remember working with that guy. He was nice. And they call you in for these projects. So that's kind of how my evolution of doing that started. And then where I got two of my biggest breaks were because of tournaments, martial arts tournaments. I was the number one competitor in the country for 4 years in a row. And I won this big tournament in Atlanta called the Battle of Atlanta. There were some producers from a TV show in the audience. And me and a couple other guys that won that night, they came up to us afterwards and said, hey, we're thinking about doing this martial arts based fighting show called WMAC Masters. Would you be interested in doing that? We're like, yeah, I'm interested in doing it. That'd be great. And then of course, and we had heard stuff like that before, producer scout, but then you don't ever hear anything. About 4 or 5 months goes by and nothing happened. And all of a sudden one day our phone rang and they go, we're going to shoot the pilot at Universal Studios in Florida. You're ready to go. And I'm like, yes, I'm ready to go. Let's do it.
And I used to watch that show too. That came on Fox. on Saturday mornings.
That's
I used to
right.
watch that too.
Right
So
on.
it's funny. So it's funny because it was just a whole lot of people that was in the Mortal Kombat franchise. Like the Liu Kang from the video game, you, the machine that was in the movie. So it was
Well,
just
listen, all
so,
those, yeah, all the main characters, the first five or six of us, the main characters, we were all the top competitors in the country at that time. Like Ho Sung Pak was the number one Chinese stylist, Hakim was number one fighter, I was the number one forms guy. So they the smartly, the producers of that show wanted to pull the best martial artists that they could find to make it look as legit and real as possible. They weren't looking for, actors. They wanted real martial artists to do it because it was a fighting-based show and they needed people that were talented. Herb Perez was the Olympic gold medalist in Taekwondo. So they brought in all the top people.
Yeah, could you just explain how that worked? Because I know it was like a studio audience, so I know that most of the like filming, was it like taping or
Yeah,
part of it was live?
none of it was live. The pilot, I think we
Okay.
did a studio audience, but it didn't really play out well and it was too difficult. So they kind of did away with that. After they shot the pilot, they made some adjustments to it. And then the show was actually, first it was called Quest for the Dragon Star, and that name was too
Okay.
long. So they changed it after the pilot to WMC Masters, changed some of the formatting, and it became the show that it was.
Okay, because I always wonder that, because me being a viewer, I would think that you guys was just doing all those fighting and stunts and all that in front of the studio audience. So thank you for clearing that up. Yeah, so how did Mortal Kombat came up? Like, so was it like a script that was presented to you, or you were just caught?
A little bit. Well, the script was not presented to me because I was still nobody in the industry, really. I had done some small movie parts here and there, like I said. And I got a call from my, at the, I finally had gotten an agent, and I got a call from my agent that said that they're looking for real martial artists to do this movie based off a video game, which is called Mortal Kombat. And I said, wow, I love that game. My two favorite characters are Raiden and Scorpion. I love those characters. And I used to drive, I used to drive 10 miles to go play this video game at this arcade way back in the day. So I really did love it. And they're auditioning for background fighters. And I'm like, cool, I want to be in a major Hollywood movie. I've never done that before. It was just like B movies and smaller budget stuff. So, we go out there to for that, and there was like 100 guys for this thing, and they needed, I think they needed 20 or 25. But the cool news for me was they had it set up like a martial arts tournament. Now, I told you, was the number one competitor in the country at that time. So the way they had the room set, I was like, oh my God, this is right in my wheelhouse. It's going to be perfect. And they had like three people sitting in a chair and they goes, just come up and show us your best stuff. So I was like, okay. And I got a chance to watch some of the people and they were really good. I'm like, oh man, I want to do something different that's going to set me apart. So I start doing my routine and I realize while the guys are sitting in the chair there, they're only about 3.5 feet high. And I go, you know what? I can clear them. And so I ran right at the guys in the chair and I did a jump sidekick over the top of them. And I remember them looking up like this and watching me go over top. And then I did a couple other moves on the other side of them and I jumped back over and landed. So that night I got a phone call and they said, hey, we want you to come back the next day. I'm like, cool, it's great. So next day I go back and there's like 50 guys. It's like less, half the group. And they had me do some more stuff. And then that night I get another phone call. We want you to come back again. And I'm like, oh my God, I'm talking to my agent. I'm like, how hard is it to be a background person in this movie? Because when I got there on the first day, they're like, all the roles are cast. We have the full thing. We just need background fighters for this scene, and you've got to be real martial artists. Cool. So I go back the third day. There's only three of us, me and two other guys. And I'm like, I don't even know what this is. I don't know what they're doing. And they had an actual movie camera there on that third day, and they were just kind of filming us. Standing there, and I'm looking at the other two guys. I'm like, I don't know what's going on. And then a guy walks over and he says, hey, would you guys mind taking off your shirts? So part of my fault as a human is I'm a little bit of a smart ass. So when he said that, and I was nervous, when he said that, I looked at him and I go, well, listen, if it will help me get in this movie, I'll go back to your trailer. So when I said that, yeah, that's what I was hoping for was that laugh. But he just looked at me deadpan, like no, that was not funny to him at all. And I was like, oh shit, whatever this is, I just lost it. Like that was my thought. So we take off our shirts, and I was a champion competitor, so I was in great shape. Guy on my left, he was a little heavy. Guy on my right, he was like a kind of okay shape. And they're just filming us. And then they go into this football huddle behind the camera for what seemed like forever. A whole bunch of people. I have no idea who they were. And then after about 30 seconds, the same guy they made the joke to walks over and shakes my hand. He says, "Welcome to Mortal Kombat. You are going to be Scorpion." So up until that moment, like, I had no idea that that part was even open or what we were doing. And so, and by the way, the guy they made the joke to ended up, he was the director of the movie, but I didn't know who he was. And so he tells the joke to say, "You thought you were being funny, but it wasn't funny." And I'm like, "I know, I was just nervous." So yeah, that's how I ended up getting the Mortal Kombat part.
Man, that's amazing.
Right place, right time. And listen, people always ask me, well, were the roles really full or were they just saying that? I don't know. I never really knew, but I'm kind of, in a way, I'm kind of glad that they didn't say any roles were open because I probably would have been more nervous. You know, for me, I was just trying to be a background fighter. So it really wasn't a lot of pressure. I was just out there having fun and doing whatever. So it wasn't until that moment that I realized that.
Man, that's amazing because I think I know what you're talking about. It was the guys that had the red turbans on and they were just standing there.
Right.
Or whatever.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Wow.
There was that. And then the guys that were background in the Goro fight, when Goro fights the Art Lean guy in the ring, there's a bunch of people cheering around the edge of the ring. That's all I thought I was going out for. So.
Man, I can imagine just being overwhelmed and excited and stuff like that, because like you really had a whole lot of sequences, even though you didn't have much lines or anything like that. You just really made an impact, just with, especially with the Johnny Cage fight, because to me that's the best fight in the movie, second to Pain and Reptile, and just how it just opens up and then you do your famous pose and you summon your spear. And it just was real epic, man. And I just always wanted to know, like, when he was going to kick you, was that the shadow kick or was that just like special effects or whatever that they
were
did?
in the beginning of the fight in the forest?
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's a great story that goes with that. So we were in Thailand filming that scene and I was there for 2 weeks, and Lyndon and I were rehearsing the fight every day. The whole fight that you see on film, we rehearsed, rehearsed, rehearsed. We had that thing dialed in. But what happened is, a lot of times with movie production, they get behind schedule. And we were only scheduled to be there for 2 weeks. And every day we would come to set, they're like, we're not going to get you today. We'll get to you tomorrow. We're not going to get to you today. We'll get to you tomorrow. We're going to get you. And they said this every day. Finally, it's the last day. And they're like, we're going to shoot your scene. So cool. So we shoot that first part. And then all of a sudden we're losing daylight. So we're out of light and out of time, but we hadn't done any of the fighting. So they said, well, we're just going to have Lyndon run at you and do this kick, and that's going to knock you out and be the fight. And I'm like, I was deflated. I was like, are you kidding me? We spent weeks rehearsing this thing. We have this amazing fight and we don't have time to do it. No, we don't have time to do it. Okay, great. Like, I'm nobody. I can't fight with the production people. Like, I'm just barely getting started in my career. So I'm like, okay, we do it. But here's where I say the power of fans, and they can control the destiny of a film. So they do, that was the shot, and he hits me and knocks me out. They go to test screen the movie now. They finish the editing, they do test screen, and they bring the audiences in. So Larry Kasdanoff tells the story. He's the producer of the film very well. And he said, when he got to the part with you and Lyndon, when he kicks you and knocks you out, the test screening audience threw their popcorn at the screen, got up and walked out and said, there's no way that Johnny Cage would beat Scorpion like that. And he goes, it didn't happen once. It happened a couple times. So we're going to reshoot the fight scenes in the movie. So because of the fans and their basically rebellion about that way that the fight was going, we got that whole Scorpion's Lair fight scene and we got a chance to shoot it. And we spent almost 3 weeks filming that fight scene alone. In that layer, which is actually in a real, that's not CGI. This is way before CGI was as good as it is today. They built that entire set inside of an airport hangar in Santa Monica. And I was literally up 20 feet in the air on that platform fighting him.
Wow. I did not know anything about that. It's crazy because.
I'm giving you a little behind the scenes right here.
Yeah. It's just because I believe the movie would have went completely different if they didn't listen to the fans, because I would be like, that's it. Because in the games, Scorpion is just like expert in Johnny Cage.
Oh,
He's
yeah.
real cocky, he's arrogant, this and that. So no, that one had not played out really well. But yeah, just doing like the research of the film, it was injuries and stuff. So, and they said that like you kicked London, right? Linden,
Lyndon.
yeah, Linden. Yeah, you kicked Linden so hard, like he crushed a rib or broke a rib or something.
I think he just got it bruised. I didn't crack it or break it, but yeah.
Okay.
But listen, that was
Yeah,
his fault. He said, "I want you to kick me. Let's make this real. I want you to kick me." And I'm
that.
like, "Lyndon, you don't want me to kick you." He's like, "No, I want you to kick me." And I'm like, "Okay." But he got me
I
back.
would
He
want
actually
to.
punched me. He actually punched me in the eye for real in one of the fight scenes. When we're going back and forth, boom, boom, boom. He actually hits me for real on one of those.
Yeah, so was that like a friendship? Because when you had like exploded or whatever, his picture came with autograph photo, and everyone says that was like a friendship from the
That
game.
was like a friendship, yep.
Wow. Yeah. And it just me being a kid, because back in 1995, I was 8 years old. So just being a kid watching that like for the
Me
first time,
too. Me too. I was only
and
9 when we filmed it.
yeah, it was just amazing because my older brother bought the game and stuff. He used to play it all the time. My sister loved the game, and me and my cousin John, we loved the game. So it was just in our family, and just to watch it and stuff and really appreciate it, and just how iconic it was, and just coming out just continuously just really was one of those things that made us feel like it was just like amazing, made us forget about our lives, our problems whenever we played the game. Because if you didn't have Mortal Kombat, you weren't in. So,
Well,
but
thank you,
yeah,
man.
man.
I appreciate that. And a lot of credit goes to Larry Kasdanoff, the producer of the film, because he wanted to do two things. One,
Yeah.
he wanted to have real martial artists doing the fighting in some of the main roles. And two, he wanted to keep it as close to the video game as possible because, if you remember back at that time, two other video game movies came out and they both tanked at the box office. And it was Street Fighter and I think Super Mario Brothers.
Yeah.
And they both came out and they didn't do well because they got away from what the game was and what the fans wanted. Larry wanted to keep it as close to the game as possible because he knew that's what fans wanted. And if he could give it to them, then things would work out. And it sure did. It was the number one movie at the box office for like 6 weeks in a row, number one soundtrack. And, it did justice to the game.
Yeah, I wish you was an annihilation. I really do. I really did wish she was annihilation.
Well, listen, I was the first person cast in Annihilation, but the problem was I had gotten the offer to do Batman and Robin. And originally the two films were supposed to shoot one right after the other. But again, Hollywood production schedules change and they overlapped. And I had already done signed the deal for Batman and I couldn't go back on that deal. And I talked to Larry and he was really cool about it. He goes, "No, I get it. It's our fault. We moved the production." And so that way I couldn't necessarily do Annihilation. But I did get to wear the bat suit, which is kind of cool.
Oh yeah. I heard about that too. But you made up for Conquest though.
That's right.
So yes, I told you I'd done my research and stuff, and I still watch it off of HBO Max to this day. I still watch
Awesome,
it.
man. Well, thank you for that. I appreciate that.
Yeah, I told you I'm a huge fan, man, and just really happy that you was able to, do well for yourself and. You have your own thing going on and stuff like that. And can you just like update us about what you got going on now, like to the viewers?
Sure. I just well, we shot a movie last year that's now out on Amazon called Cop versus Killer. My friend Matt Page wrote it, directed, and stars in it. It's kind of an action thriller thing that's out now. And then now the actor strike is over. I think in March or April of next year, I've got a new movie that is scheduled to start filming, which is kind of a sci-fi action adventure thing. In between those gigs, I'm overseeing operations of our studios. We've got 17 Red Dragon Karate Studios here in Southern California. We're on track to have 20 by the end of next year. So that keeps me busy.
Okay. Congratulations on that, man. And
Thank you.
it's crazy because, like, your episode 592. So I'm going to cherish this episode forever, man.
Right on.
Because I'm just a young man from a small town in Michigan, Saginaw, Michigan, and stuff like that. And, like, you really gave me a whole lot of credibility today.
All right, man. Well, listen, when you start accepting awards for your show, I want you to thank me.
Oh yeah, you top five for sure.
All right. Top five. Man, you're gonna get me top three.
Yeah, you know, I gotta thank God. I gotta thank my mom, my
I got
father,
you.
Then you, you know, because
okay.
Cause
all right. Well, if that's the order, I'm good with that.
Yeah,
those are
yeah.
all more important than me.
Yeah. And I would like to ask you, would you like to return just to give us like a follow-up and stuff like that, like in the near future?
Yeah, man. Yeah. Especially like I said, you know, hit me up in the first quarter of next year. Hopefully I'll have a bigger, better movie to talk about, and always happy to come back, my man.
Oh, always, man. And you just gave me an early birthday present too. Yeah.
Right on.
Yeah,
When's your birthday?
Oh, it's January 8th. I'll be
Hey,
36 years old.
I'm January 17th.
Wow, you got the same birthday as my father.
Really? That's
Yeah.
awesome. And we have the same birthday as Muhammad Ali.
Yeah. Jim Carrey too.
Yep.
Yeah. Man. But yeah, if I don't get to see you, happy birthday, man. And
And
again,
same to you.
Thank you. Thank you. And again,
And
I appreciate this.
Yeah, man, good luck with your show, and keep me posted on your progress, and, you know, more good things to come.
Okay, thank you, man.
All right, and I'm going to shoot you the link to this as well so that you have it.
Okay, thank you, man. Appreciate it.
All right.
All right,
buddy, have a great rest of your day.
All right, you too.
See ya.